How is there a budget constraint when the country is losing $2 billion to corruption? Can you use that money to transmit this information down here? How is there a budget constraint, Osiany, at where you sit, when 5 years the country has been stagnating in the fight against corruption?
Hello and welcome to the BBC Africa special Kenyan election youth debate. My name is Boni Tunya. Youth between 18 and 35 years make up 75% of the Kenyan population, yet they remain largely excluded from policymaking and governance. The upcoming election in August has been identified as a point of pivot for the country and is expected to be unlike any other because of several issues that the Kenyan youth deeply care about. These include livelihoods, governance, and inclusivity. And so we ask, has the country's leadership failed the youth?
You're 7 of you as youthful people there. Between the time you got in and up to this time that you're already getting out in the next 2 months, oh, God forbid you're not getting out. What have you done? What difference, what big difference have you done that you can show to this youth, Osiany?
Thank you so much. And thank you, sir, for your question. And Osiany, I'd like to paraphrase the last question which he asked, because a lot of people are saying there's a lot of youthful leaders out there, but we don't feel their impact. So perhaps if you could frame it in the way of what sort of assurances do the young people have that those in government like yourselves are actually representing them?
No, I actually like the questions as they have been raised. Mm-hmm. The question around what I would do if I were president, and God bless you for that prayer. May it come to pass from your mouth to God's ears. And what the challenges that are. First, I think the last congregant must have not listened to me saying that whereas there are those budgetary constraints, I have utilized my social media platform. My total followership is shy of 200,000, but I've utilized it correctly to create a segment for informing public. I think at a personal level, that is what I could do, and that is what I have continued to do. Yes, graft has been a problem. The president himself saying that we lose nearly 30% of our national budget to graft. Have there been processes towards addressing that? Yes. Are those processes within my purview and ability to resolve? No. They lie within the Judicial Service Commission, the judiciary and other instruments of state or judicial management to execute, put in place policies and stop us from losing this money. So I understand your frustration. What have I done in the last 1.5 years that I've been in office, because I've only had the privilege of being in office for 1.5 years. I've been the biggest champion for putting out information and communication out there. I utilize my networks both on tele and radio and on my personal platform to get the word out. Number two, I've been at the forefront of creating what is the country's first micro and small enterprise policy. This country never even had one. They didn't even know how to describe an SME. What is a small, what is micro, what is an enterprise, and to what extent? I've been at the forefront of that. I have been at the forefront of working alongside other agencies to try and create youth-centric policies so that when we are talking Africa Continental Free Trade Area, until my appointment, the conversations about involvement of young people and SMEs in the Africa Continental Free Trade Area policy in Kenya was none heard of until we were at the table. What I am saying is, given an opportunity, and I need to inform the audience, when you walk into government, you will learn, and I tell you this from experience, that there are biases against age. So people will think that because you're young, sometimes you don't know. But you have to be bold enough by demonstrating what you know. The moment you demonstrate your capability and ability, they will bow down to you and need you. You will be the important cog that runs the place and the stage you are in. It's not enough to be young until you can add value. And so I really hope that even as we speak about young people and their place in government, they're able to understand as well that show up, but show up with knowledge. I like what Maura said. Let's be well-read, let's be informed, let's deliberately try to learn. What would I do if I were president today? I would ensure, in terms of integrating our young people, mm-hmm. that promises such as I've heard as Emir saying that 20% of cabinet will be young people is really to young people. That all government boards, parastatal boards, have a 10% at the very least
right.
of young people on that board, on the basis of age alone, or 20 as such.
Right.
I would ensure that even at the principal secretary level, directorate level, leave alone the raised level of being a cabinet secretary, where right. the rubber meets the road is below that. And so I just hope that when that chance is given to you as young people, you show yourselves diligent, honest, candid, and patriotic above all. Right. Patriotic to country and not to self and pocket.
I just want to begin with this. Gone are the days where we thought the youths are the leaders of tomorrow, because to be sincere, tomorrow is just a fantasy. So youths are the leaders of today. But now the question is, is there hope for the youths? In all institutions, it can be inclusion in the economy, in politics. Is there really hope, or here we are just for the debate?
Yeah. Ronnie, is there hope for the youth?
I think there's hope. You know, you can feel the energy in the room. And, you know, when you see the kind of passion that our young people have, the kind of ambition they have for this country, the demand that they have to be included and to be part of the process, that in itself indicates that there's hope. I think we need to be fixing some things. Some are legal, some are structural, some are societal, like somebody mentioned, that need to be fixed. I want to dissuade our young people from believing that politics is cheap. It's not. Not just in Kenya, anywhere in the world. Political campaigning is an extremely expensive affair, anywhere. The skill you need to learn with that, however, and I'm not saying that there are things we cannot fix. I think there are things we can fix. We can have a more progressive agenda for inclusion of young people in political processes. But I think the youth need to understand that to go into political campaigning, you need to have very strong fundraising skills. And you need to invest. So it needs to be a long run. It needs to be something that you don't just wake up one day and say, Lindy, for example, deserves a better MCA. And you wake up in the middle of the night, and the next day you've started printing posters. It's the long run. And I think as leaders of tomorrow, you need to appreciate that leadership is also about patience. It's the long game. The leaders of today. Okay, sorry, leaders of today. It's the long game. And right. You know, I for all those who are invested in politics, I normally say there are three things you need in politics.
Right.
One is a strong narrative. What do you want to offer the people? You have to think through that. You have to invest in it. You have to study it so that you have the right solutions. The second thing is you need to build a network. You cannot do it alone. The more you build your network, the more likely it is that it is going to be cheaper on you and easier on you.
Right.
But the last thing, and most importantly, is that you must have money. It is as simple as that. You can't avoid it.
What's your role in ensuring that, you know, with us here, we are empowered through education, we are at our degree levels, some are at masters, and how will you ensure that the other guys who just completed an O level, others from who dropped out of school, How will you empower them and know and tell them that this is a clear-cut difference between reality and a propaganda?
Right.
Because that's the only thing that's affecting our society. Because you find that a politician is inciting you to hate this guy without a reason. And the reverse is the true.
I educate youth on how they can request information from the government. Sometimes it comes with struggle and fight. It doesn't come automatically. And it's to be persistent with the request for information. Where I see the lack is, unfortunately, our government works with pressure. So we have to continuously push that pressure. And there was something about, you know, right to life. So I know with the case of Abby, there was a lot of information going around online and people sort of bringing back that case. But then, you know, again, with the consistency, we haven't followed up with it. Sometimes from where I sit, that responsibility, unfortunately, falls on civil society organizations. And we get burnt out. Right now in Kenya, the number of civil society organizations working in the field is decreasing. If you compare it to the 90s, it has gone down. And I fear, because when I look at young civil society actors, there are not many of them, and those who are coming up need a lot of mentorship and support. So for the future...
Sorry, quick question. Is it shrinking because it's a captured space, or is it a resource issue? What exactly is the issue?
It's a resource issue. right now globally, a lot of countries are looking internally. You know, we've seen COVID, we've seen the economic disrupt, we've seen Ukraine and Russia, the wars. So countries are not giving as much grant funding as they did because a lot of civil society depend on that. Government sometimes works with civil society organizations and they have that partnership. But Kenya also changed. When we moved to a middle class economy, now a lot of these foreign agencies support the government directly. And so it has also cut out how much is going towards civil society. Right. So there's that. And it's also shrinking in a sense because there's been a lot of conversation about freedom of expression and how you can utilize your platforms and social media. So it's still a very experimented space. We might actually, maybe one day, hopefully not, have an internet shutdown. We've already seen it with the media. But then we hope it won't happen with the internet.
And there's a lot of young people who have ability or who are passionate about this country, but they can't, in the life of them, figure out how to get in government. How did it work for you?
First, let me say to the young lady who said she was told to pay for industrial attachment, that's not the policy of government. And so whoever asked you, I am willing and able, I want you to tell me who it was so that I, on your behalf, can deal with them. And I mean this is not for show or for TV. Secondly, young people are often invited but not involved. I speak from experience and the hurdles I've had to go through as a minister of state. And it goes back to what our dear lady, the chair of the Hindu Council said, you know, we just don't trust young people. Yet, Bonnie, we have to agree that some of us who are young and have been on the stage before have messed it for the ones who are young who have come after us. You have parliamentarians who are young, and when you ask them truly, what value have you brought to legislation in parliament? I guarantee you, without mentioning names, we will know them for their slogans than we will know them for their contribution to the legislation of this country. That therefore means that those of us who are afforded a chance on the table must be absolutely exemplary so that we create a pathway for those who come after us. I am a big, big proponent for creating quotas for young people in leadership. It will not happen by fluke. There has to be a sense of affirmative action, just as we have seen with women. That is why progressively the quality of women leaders in our country has improved, because you had a constitution that said, we shall have a women representative at the county level. Then that becomes a fight for women alone. Right. Over time, then you see a lady like, say, Gladys Wanga, having been refined by that affirmative process, now she can run for governor and beat male governors. Never mind, you had people like Ngilu who did it before. If we are going to have the young people involved, the government must create quotas for young people. They must decide that they have, this is how we are going to structurally involve young people. However, young people must know that it is not enough to be invited on that table. You must demonstrate value for your invitation. You must be well-read. You must acquaint yourself with the skills. You must show yourself exemplary. For we are the country, Bonnie, I have stated before,
right,
that had Tom Mboya at the age of 33 becoming the Minister for Economic Development for this country, together with Kibaki, but they did not just become ministers. They left behind a footprint which to date is indelible. They left behind what is touted left, right, and center as sessional paper number 10, which was adopted by even Asian countries like right. Malaysia, and they outpaced us. Right. That is when young people applied themselves to the positions they have been offered. And so young people, it's great to be on the table, but it's not enough to be on that table. You must add value to that table, make a place for yourselves and secure an opportunity for the young ones who will come after you.
I came to Kenya when I was 9 years old. Kenya is actually my country. So when I'm locked out, because here in Kenya, there's what is called bureaucracy barriers. You need an internship like myself or any other person who is not a Kenyan citizen. You are told that you need a work permit. In this country, there's a part of community that is believed from South Sudan. The same route that they used to come to Kenya and that they are taken as part of a Kenyan society, the same route I used. Why is me not also not recognized to be part of Kenya?
That's a tough one, but it's also the fact that even in Kenya itself, people born in Kenya don't have IDs in some counties in our country, and they can't vote. So I do believe we have a lot of historical injustices that even as youth, we don't even understand them. Or I feel that our country hasn't come to terms with teaching us about them and the process of healing. Because I think that we do become one when we look at athletes winning championships. I mean, when we see a Kenyan winning an Olympic or boxing or running, we're always like, we're proud to be Kenyan, and that's where we come out and we do not care about tribe. But then where it now becomes an issue is this period during elections. And as I was listening to Ronnie speak about, you know, the things that you need, the network, the resources and all that, having a husband running for member of parliament, the conversations that I'm around, I mean, we cannot get around the tribal blocks. We are still discussing that. We are. And so as soon as we begin to look at our elective politics as not tribal, ethnic positioning, and I think that consensus has made it worse.
Right. And Nirema, on that point, I'd like to pick a question that you had, and I want to throw it to the audience as a yes or no question. Do you care about the tribe of your political leader? No?
Are you serious? Are you honest? This one's...
Right. Is there somebody who said yes?
Do your parents care?
All right. It's a split opinion. After the dust has settled, I think the bigger question is, how then do we ensure an open and accountable future for Kenya's youth?
Yeah, and you know, first I just want to, on the back of this conversation around corruption, and because I think the future of the youth in Kenya is actually pivoted on what I want to say. I think the biggest challenge in Kenya today is values. And the framers of our constitution spoke to millions of Kenyans and framed what we then all purposefully called our national values. But if we asked ourselves, how practical have we been about inculcating these values? In fact, I could give a test to the audience here today and ask them, what are our national values? And I can guarantee you 99% will fail. It is precisely because we have not invested in translating what we wished for as a nation into what we actually practically want to become. And once we start talking about, you know, integrity and honesty and hard work and those becoming our core values, then we will address a lot of the issues that we actually have today. Somebody given a duty will do it diligently, will do it honestly, and we'll do it with the most that they can actually give to that job, which will then translate to better outcomes and better impact, not just for the youth, but for all Kenyans.